Okay, great. Well, welcome all to Freedom Hall. This is the home of the Freedom Socialist Party in New York. It's our local branch, and we're really happy to host you guys and the campaign. It's very close to the issues we advocate for as a socialist feminist political party. And Akeem and I have been talking. We think it's we are currently engaged in a campaign for police accountability that is to accomplish an elected civilian review board as a way to create police accountability. And this is a campaign that we started with a number of individuals and groups. It's a growing coalition that's been around for just under a year now, so it's really blowing up. Obviously, I don't need to talk about the headlines and more examples of police violence and with no charges being brought, and also just the day-to-day violence and aggressions that the community faces from the police in New York City. So what would this what would the elected civilian review board be? It's a couple of has a couple of key qualities. Basically, the campaign is organizing to make amendments to the city charter to create an elected civilian review board body. So it would be a board made up of people from the community, people like us, who would be elected from all boroughs of New York and represent the communities most affected by police violence. They would be elected. They would also be empowered to enact discipline over police. So they would investigate all incidents of police misconduct, alleged, and they would be able to make decisions and assessments that would be binding over the police department. That leads up into discipline in terms of retraining, all the way up to firing of cops. Now, an important sister arm of the elected civilian review board would be the elected special prosecutor. So this is the person, the position that we would also, we're also fighting to legislate that would bring up charges against cops that have criminal conduct. So most of the big cases involving police murder, that's how justice would be won, is through the elected special prosecutor, independent of the DA. And I know we all know the district attorney has a huge conflict of interest in all cities from that prevents them from really prosecuting cops.
Yeah. I was wondering how, so when it comes to like community interaction, like how would we get involved
with the campaign now, yeah, as it stands? So we actually have alternating meetings on the other Thursday of this campaign. We happen to be here in a coexisting moment, but usually we're here on the other week. And that's our regular twice a month meetings, but it's also not contingent on involvement. It's a we would be, first of all, love to have the endorsement of your campaign, of ours. That would be a real political statement. We would also love to endorse your campaign.
Yep.
We have a number of actions happening. We are having a big open mic speak out fundraiser at the end of the month at the Shrine, the venue right close here in Harlem.
The Shrine? Where's that?
Just a couple, couple blocks up. And then I think it's just would be really great if we could keep a dialogue up between the groups, because the issues of incarceration, justice, which you guys are in the lead of, and accountability are so interrelated. So,
yeah.
Of the Freedom Socialist Party and other groups, including Michael Zinzin, who is a former Black Panther, and that was during the Rodney King era. So there was a movement of sorts around police violence, but not like we've seen today. So we revived it, and We think that it's the time for it. We think the community is with us. If we can show the real political principles beyond it that make it different from the city business as usual. So the main reason is we need to collectivize our efforts, and we need a concrete reform that the community can organize around. And that's what we think this is.
So how do you involve the community? What exactly?
So that's a really critical element, and in the organizing and advocating for it, it's a huge effort to actually do outreach, to educate the community, to make materials that are very clear, to funnel people into the organizing that's happening so that they can actually be leaders in the leadership of it, and to get their feedback on the language, the actual components, political components of the legislation. And we have people from the community here that aren't from activist organizations that have just joined, and we need to build on that.
I've been activist, done a lot of stuff, but Shut Down Rikers is probably my bread and butter. Yeah, I guess I'm gonna say things.
As most of you already know, my name is Akeem Browder. I started the campaign to Shut Down Rikers with a collection of grassroots organizers that decided enough is enough with Rikers Island. And if you know my brother Khalid Browder, he, after serving 3 years on Rikers and then being released without having a conviction or, you know, we're doing introductions if you want to just sit in. Right, yeah. And so basically, I mean, we're building a campaign to shut down Rikers, but also maneuvering ourselves into activism nationwide. And yeah, we're going around in a circle, so okay.
Khalid's name every single day on the internet, and it's just horrific. I know people who have been to Rikers. I know people who spent 3 years on Rikers personally, my family members. So it's a definitely an issue that touches me, and I'm happy to be with a group of people that really want to shut down Rikers.
My name is Tomas Bantilla. I'm with the campaign Shut Down Rikers, and I got to know about the topic also because of the internet. I'm a photojournalist, so I wanted to work around the topic and tell stories visually of people who were inside. And like that, I met Akeem and I got involved in the campaign, and I'm glad to be here.
Thanks.
Hey, I'm Ollie. I'm a documentary student at Columbia Journalism School, but I've covered a lot of criminal justice in the past year, and did a radio story for class on this group. I interviewed Akeem before. Yes,
I'm
very happy to be here.
Thanks for coming.
Hello, I'm Sergey. I've been a political prisoner back in Russia. I'm like a political refugee now in the United States. I don't like prison, so that's why I joined Shut Down Rikers.
Thanks.
My name is Sid Jogue. I'm a visual artist. I've taught on Rikers before in the juvenile detention facility. And I'm working on a documentary right now on the psychological impact of aggressive and violent policing on young men of color. I'd like to put a story in, you know, the work that you're doing to somehow make it some impact. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming.
Hi, my name is Tia. I'm working on this documentary, and I'm here with him getting information and really trying to support his cause.
I am Lana. I'm new to the campaign. I got interested because I met Akeem and learned about his brother. And also, I have a young son, and I don't want him to experience what, you know, anyone who's been on Rikers experience. So I'm just getting all the information and learning.
Thanks.
I'm Jackie Hunt, Akeem's mom. Just found my amazing son, and I'm so excited to getting to know him and know what this whole, what his whole campaign is about, and I'm excited to be supportive of it. I have two other boys, so three total, and it's so important for me to figure out what's going on and the black boys, so I want to learn what it is that I have to do to be able to support them as well.
Thanks for coming, Mom.
Yeah, absolutely. My name is Craig Williams, Photo Patch. I'm an organization, which I just said, Photo Patch. We allow children who have parents who are incarcerated to upload their photos and letters to our website, and we send their photos and letters to their parents free of charge. So, me personally, I'm formerly incarcerated. I never have been on Rikers Island. I've heard of Rikers Island and the cruelty of such. I've been in state correctional facilities, state prisons like Walk Hill, Sing Sing, Elmira, and so on and so forth. And I know the cruelty that exists up there in those mountains. So I can imagine just what cruelty and humane torture on Rikers.
Yeah. Thanks for being here. What's your second name was again?
Craig Williams.
First, it's an honor to meet you, Queen. Second, my name is Five Mwam Ak. I'm the co-founder of the Incarcerated Nation Corporation. Really quick, INC, as he's around, is a collective of projects. We're also a speakers bureau, so each one of us is directly impacted, and each one of us has our own nonprofit, so we become incorporated a sort of collective of projects as well. I'm here because I believe in the King and his project, and I support him 100%. I also believe that this project is not the potential, but is a national issue, right? And when we say shut down, it's actually a system of the people's voice. It is not the system saying we need to fix it or correct it or straighten it. We're talking about shutting down the institution. So we're talking about literally tearing down walls, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is the movement that we need to do on a local level. Because if we don't, we can't think about the entire state unless we think about the counties in between and the jail to feed the prison system. It is a feeding system, it is a pipeline that goes straight from school, but also from other angles of the community, and we have the ability to do that, and I would love to help and assist in any way, of course. And more so, I've been doing this work, I'm directly impacted as well. Spent a lot of time in solitary, and I think that's why your brother's case touched me so much. Besides, at the time, I was doing a lot of media and sort of connected the New Yorker with Rikers and a lot of other activism that has led to the exposure of conditions. Once you expose something, you're responsible for the outcome of that. So it's not just about saying we should move the kids, it's being actively productive in the form of where they're going, monitoring them, making sure that there's programs, and making sure they're right to them. And that's for everyone. So I sort of feel myself responsible. I'm actually late today because we had a person who just got out of prison, and I have run a reentry center as well, and we had to get him to Nassau County before a certain time, so it was a little bit of a rush. But we work together because this problem affects all of us, directly impacted. Number one, J School, Columbia, love that. I train journalism students every year. I'm also go to Columbia as well, so we also have a huge student group. And that together represents different citizens. So we have citizens here that may have not been directly impacted, but everyone is directly impacted, and I'm gonna say that, right? If you're not in prison, you're paying for it. If you're not paying for it, you're paying for the products that are made in prison.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a huge structure where everyone has an involvement, everybody has their ownership in it. Yes, we are directly impacted, and we work mostly on conditions of confinement and the rights of those inside, but to be honest, everyone is directly impacted, and I want everyone to know that here today. I heard people say, I'm here for this, I'm here for that. Well, you're here because you're paying for the system, whether it's in the state or inside the state. And I think that we have the ability to shut that down. And that's what Shut Down Rikers is about. It's also about shutting down the system, the cruelty, and the accountability. Start from a national sort of model. It means you have to find pockets for those who, in Akeem's dream, in some sense, that we share a common vision where people don't have to stop doing what they're already doing. You're a filmmaker. Continue doing that. We would like to support and help you to make films that have direct impact and also voices of those directly impacted, right? You're a journalist student. We want more journalism out there about that. So everyone sort of stays in their lane, but come together as a collective unit, right? And I believe that certain structures can be built in now so that it can be a national template for other states and other counties as well.
Overflow. So what we also are part of is re-education.
we have to charge ourselves to re-educate our people of New York City so that when we're speaking, we're not using the wrong words, which is common in terminology for American English, to say jail and prison in the same context or form. Yet we all know, or if you don't know, welcome to the legalese of jail term or the Department of Correction terms. It's a jail, it's not a prison. And when you have a corporation like the Department of Corrections operating as a prison, you have a problem because they don't have the right to. So being that you're in jail, or a person that's in jail, you are still entitled to rights because you're not a convicted felon yet, and you're definitely not guilty at that point.
Right.
And in that case, we have that we're charged, and what we try to do is charge the public to understand and re-educate themselves on just first verbology. The verbiage of what we use on a daily basis is not the same when we come into the realm of prison or abolition work. So I believe we're dedicated to, one, re-educating the public and letting them know that there's also a vision for where we want to take this. Now, to Shut Down Rikers, we can say that it'll happen, and I believe it's going in that direction that it's going to happen, but our job doesn't stop there. So to have a foresight of something in the future is what I'm envisioning, so that we can have, one, prominence and in having our foot in the door of every jail and having our mouths in the ear of everybody in the United States. If we could take it further, we could take it further. But we want to reach a goal of being nationwide, and we can start with this gentleman who has connections out in California with
when you talk about re-education, let's all be understood that Rikers is the second largest jail in the country, the planet. It's also the second largest penal colony, which means out of any jail or prison, it's the most occupied. In other words, we don't have a jail in New York State with the amount of people in that one. We don't have a prison in New York State with the amount of people in that jail.
Hmm.
So understand the terminology. When you're saying prison, you're talking about a whole different NICE COBRA, which is the city union, but there's a whole different, NICE COBRA for the state, you have COBRA for the city. So it's two different unions, and you don't want to, when you're being a vocal and a visible voice, visible means you have to be accountable for what you say, right? The other thing is the most logical allies is the first largest prison in California, right? And that is also, we have a huge collective out there, but we've been waiting to sort of create and formulate it. So it's already waiting there, brewing in some sense, right? Because there's smaller pockets. What we want to do is organize them, and also very talking about shutting down as in an abolition sense, and that may start with what we do in Rikers, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of y'all don't know, but we founded also the Jails Action Coalition and other collective projects who have been doing a lot of the work. Now that's great, but it's not really for direct action. It is more so for legal action, because we have to play all sides. We have to be outside, visible. We have to make sure that we're recruiting public and educating them. We also have to be inside, calm, collective, and saying, no, this is what rules look like. What you have is minimum standards. You
mm-hmm.
see, jail, when you figure a jail, you think of like the county jail with the sheriff, and there's the one drunk guy in the cell, right? And he's going to be there only overnight. So he gets a meal, maybe, or buy lunch on a short budget, right? That's what county jails run off. Rikers runs off the same issues, because they only give you... Does anybody know what minimum standards is? So minimum standards is just enough to keep you alive. Just enough clothes so you won't freeze to death, which we know still happens. Just enough clothes so you won't bake to death, which we know still happens. And just enough to feed you so you can stay alive. Does anybody know the nutritional amount that a human being needs to live? It's actually very small. Right, so they don't have to prepare hot food, they can give you sandwiches or two pieces of cold cut in the bread, and that's it, because it's a county jail. Now, this happens to be the world's largest county jail.
Yep.
That your average stay is a year to 2 to 3 years. So it doesn't have the requirements of a county jail, right? Yes, the speedy trial bill is important, but it's the system that structured it, right?
Mm-hmm.
That it's an average stay on that length of time. That means they should be treated more like a prison, but also under those rules of living conditions. And yes, they've been restricting, but we have a team of lawyers who are there every day, every meeting, at the BOC, writing responses, and that needs to be expounded, because even though they're lawyers, but there's thousands of people in our community, and the citizens have more of a voice.
But it's also a commodity. If they can get someone to take a plea, then they have what they want, a goal of getting another felon, getting financially paid off for that felon, and then having the recidivism rate of, I mean, the recidivism rate in the United States for someone going back to jail is guaranteed. So you take away someone's life, what we're trying to do is give back that thought on that life and stop it from happening. Just knowing you for the last couple of days, he's done amazing work with Spofford in
that was one of the first facilities.
200,
did,
right?
Justice, yeah.
And to hire 200 felons to work in a jail as counselors?
Yeah, they're doing that at Corizon. So, Safe Corizon and the commissioner for ACS.
Yes.
So we've been working with Felipe, and sometimes we have to, like I said, do the entire picture. So yes, we're at the Board of Corrections, like, we need to move the kids off of Rikers, but where they're going? Where are they gonna go? So we have to also, in the community, attack where they're going, make sure that they're prepared to receive them, because you can't play the game of, if we had a place, we would send them. It's funny you said that, because I have Tyrone Muhammad, who works at the Correctional Association, and one phone call, he tells me there's only 45 kids here. So we can move those people actually out of four up and then put all the kids there.
Yeah.
And then they take a year to do that, so we had to actually work with Felipe and actually have him be understanding of the system he controls. So that took him to actually meet and sit down and put him on a panel. This is how we do things interactively, and I invite him to a film screening. Just so happens that the film screening is Raymond Santana.
Hmm.
And the Princeton professor who wrote the report called Super Predators about kids and how 41 states made juvenile laws, and this is how the system started off with somebody who was innocent.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, why don't you come out and sit next to this panel? And then he feels silly because he controls that juvenile system. And then the system had a meet, no problem, had my friend Joe Kennedy III come in and talk about how his grandfather addressed the juvenile system and then created it because it was meant to keep kids out of court. It was meant to keep kids out of a proceeding that
it's
looked like
for
the criminal justice system.
Exactly.
And then we created a movie, and I put him in a film called Prison Kids, right? So all of this kind of changed him, and he fired all the staff and literally rehired all of the counselors, took all of the shirts away from them, mace, everything that looks like a CO. They wear T-shirts and polos, and they are counselors, and he hired people previously incarcerated with preference.
200.
Right.
So we're expanding what I entitled here. So our website, I don't know if you've been to it. Oh, actually, this website you can have gone to because we haven't published it yet. But when it's published, it has a page here, which is Alternatives to Prison. So giving a vision of what Alternatives to Prison looks like is a essential key. We need a vision, or else the people continue saying what we find a lot when we go on the street. What is a question that they ask all the time when you go to a person that says, oh, do you want to help be a part of a campaign that shuts down a racist organization? What's the first thing they tell you?
What are they
going to
do with the guilty people?
What are you going to do with the criminals is a lot what we hear.
Right.
Well, one, they're not criminals. So re-education right there. That's one thing that we can start with. But then alternatively, giving them a vision of saying, well, we actually have a format, which I met a Dades County judge in Florida who decided they're going to shut down. They started with shutting down four of their jails and instituted a system of mentorship. So you have someone that goes to jail, and he first started with mentoring in the jail. But when they went out, they didn't have that mentor, that comfort, that support. So they wanted to come back to jail. And actually, that Dade County judge, was asked that one guy he kept on seeing over and over again, why are you still back in my court? And the kid actually told him, it's because he doesn't have support out on the street. You give someone a felony, what are they going to do with their lives if they don't have the education and tools necessary to bring them out of their rut? So he decided put a mentor on the street and a mentor in the jail. But by doing that, he then closed down 14 of his jails. There's only four jails in Dades County. And by those jails, he's looking to shut down, but instituting, because when we talk about statistics in Rikers Island, anyone knows the statistic of how many mentally ill is on Rikers Island?
In
population, or no, in period.
In period, in population, and in solitary?
In solitary, no, in total, yeah.
In total, it's 82.
Yeah.
So, 82% of people. See, Rikers doesn't do assessment. One of the first things that we did is create a system with Dr. Home Adventures to create assessment. That never existed, so there's already people there decades in the cycle through, right? So that when, what does assessment mean to y'all?
Evaluation.
Right, totally. Like to find out if a are you mentally ill? Let me find out. Oh, this is a jail. We don't have the time to do that. You're gonna be here for a few days.
Huh.
Right? So it's a system of rush when it needs to be, when it's convenient for them. But there's no accountability later because it's like, oh, we don't know you're in, you know, we didn't know you were schizophrenic. Mm-hmm. We didn't know that you have bipolar disorder, mm-hmm. right? So these type of mental illness is also uncategorized because mental health is handled by three different structures in Rikers. You have DOHMH, you have DOH, and you also have Horizon, which is this healthcare privatized system, right? And you had Montefiore at one time, mm-hmm. but they invested in Rikers when there was a whole HIV epidemic, and they pulled out. Actually, the head of Montefiore is on the board now. So I say that to say that without assessment, you have no accountability, because you can put anybody anywhere. You know, oh, I didn't know he was mentally ill. It's like you don't have the facilities to actually take the time and interview him or get their records, because if you don't sign to have permission, that doctor cannot just go get your records. And if you had a privatized hospital, he can't get your records. So we created this sort of cloud system. So that's some things that just extensively didn't exist, which means you had a huge lot of people. But people always ask me that question, like, why are so many people with mental illness in the prisons? But we in the society have to take responsibility to that, because when Reagan cut community-based funding for mental health facilities, by 1985, they were on the streets. And who do we hire in 1985? Commissioner Bratton. And he makes public enemy number one, the homeless. So we made anti-vacancy laws, anti-payment laws, anti-trespassing laws, quality of life laws, curfew laws. We basically made it illegal to be homeless. Hmm. And then we lock those people up.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a hard time thriving in society, how can you thrive in this microcosmic environment without medication or proper treatment? And so those people are thrown into isolation where they exacerbate their conditions, right? So 80% of people in Rikers Island all suffer from mental illness, but the youth itself, the 76% of youth all suffer from mental illness and are receiving psychotropic drugs. Right? That is damaging, I'm talking about undeveloped brains, because we happen to live in a state where 16-year-olds, you're an adult. I happen to own a 16-year-old, not too responsible, but he's an adult if he's locked up. He's in charge of all his medical history and everything legally he has to have to himself, and they can't even talk to his parents. And then on top of that, there's no accountability to even get his medical records, even if he agreed. So it becomes a system where they just put you in a cage and anything happens to you, just happens.
I wanted to make sure that we are using each other for the work of abolition work, utilizing our time that we can dedicate, which if that's only 10%, that's 10%. That means you have a family, you have a job, and you can only get 10% to the campaign. Well, then that 10%, what would it look like? How can we utilize you? How can we make sure our goal of shutting down Rikers doesn't just become a goal that doesn't get accomplished, but becomes a goal that can flourish and we can thrive on? So we were charged in the beginning with the goal of getting at least 2,500 people signed onto the petition so that we can have a voice because we petitioned Mayor de Blasio, Governor Cuomo, and Ponte. So in that petition, we stated that we're gathering names so that we control the vote process when you want to get voted into office in 2017. That is scary for them, because if we have the majority of the votes, then what we have, they don't get in office. So then they want to hear our conditions. In that case, we need a committee built to or we need committees built to following our goals. So one of our goals to have 2,500 people, which is not a big number actually. We did how many in like two in one day?
2 days. 250,000 and another half a million in 2 weeks, yeah.
So it's not hard. People actually want to be a part of something. So how do we get them apart? Just like you guys are here, how do we get them apart? Have committees set up already. So what we're trying to do is, or what we're looking to do as of now is setting up committees. Like if you want to be a part of media, like our friend here, Thomas, he is a great photographer and he's put together videos where I'm bragging your work, but the work of all of us, because basically what we do is we interview, families that, and actually you'll be able to see this. oops, you'll be able to see it when we publish the website. But sorry, I didn't mean to cut you guys off, cut it off. But basically, the work that we that we're doing is we have a project which is on our project page, Humans of Rikers. We want to take the real stories that the news is not covering, the stories of the families that the Department of Corrections, the Board of Department of Justice, and that the police are ruining our families and our society's lives by sending them to jail. What do you think happens when you go to jail and you have a job, you have a family, you go to jail, you lose your job because you're not getting out in less than 8 months, at the very least. It's just the way it's set up. But then on top of that, you lose your family. Your kids are scared, is daddy ever, or mommy, or my brother ever coming home? So we want to tell their stories. So what we do is, one example, we go to Rikers at 1 to 4 in the morning, because this is when they're releasing detainees. And when you release them, they're on a bus going home at night, and we approach them with, hey, can we tell your story at a later time? I know you're just coming home, blah, blah, blah. But this provides people for us to tell stories so that we can get their story out there. They get some kind of justice, because sometimes they don't even believe that they should have even, well, none of them really believe they should be in jail. But for an open canister, why should you go to jail when that is a violation, it's a violation. So why put me on Rikers when you could just write me a ticket? But police are KKK, they just do what they want. So anyway, we have this project. We have committees that we want to set up so that you can join these committees, be a part, even if it's that 10% that you want to volunteer for, and that 10% will look like what? So if you're in media, if you're in committees for training for, so what we're hoping to do is do educational talks, so speaking at colleges, educating, and through him this is going to be possible, teaching on prison reform or prison...
And conditions of confinement.
In solitary. So we want to attack one, shutting down Rikers, but also there's other jails in the United States. So we, by becoming nationwide, joining with groups outside like the California...
So it's a California Hunger... It's the California Families Against Solitary Confinement. That's one collective. And then it's CCDR, which is the county facility. And they were going to call themselves Shut Down the Jail. It's going to call themselves Jail's Action. But I'm pausing that because I'm going out there Monday to sort of talk to them about organizing and being the second chapter of what we're doing here.
Yeah.
So the systems that exist here exist in every state.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is that we have 50 different states. So you have 50 different prison systems and 50 different ways of doing things. So individual state collectives is what we build. And like we have this community control over police, right? So we also have a voter campaign and it works together. Our campaign in Jim Crow, we have 9,000 voters on Rikers Island right now.
Yep.
All legally able to vote. Right, they cannot stop us from going to vote. So when I contacted Robin today, I sent them over like, look, I'm coming in to do voter registration. It's not something I'm asking you. It's something we've been doing for a long time, but haven't been doing lately. Because you're not convicted of anything.
Exactly.
How are you able to vote, right? Oh, we're able to vote through the library. Oh, but there's no law that says libraries have to have librarians.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to put that, oh, no, don't worry, I already got that bill. It's already in committee. It's already done. You have to let us in. The other thing is I'm working on creating a release program for them so that they give people our office address with a Metro card. Docs loves to do that to throw responsibility off of us. But that's perfect because they don't have to be at Rikers at 1 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
We already know who's coming here and they're
right.
Coming right to our office,
right?
Right? So this whole system is how we can contain and also have information. But remember, Rikers is not unique. It is unique, but it represents every jail in America.
Mm-hmm.
Because every jail, they're still shackling women when they're pregnant, right? They're still not giving sanitary napkins and commissary. Like literally, so these conditions that we have here is a template for activism and social justice for other states as well.
That leads into the other project, which is the Women of Rikers,
mm-hmm.
which, I mean, whether they're transgender, women of color, they're being sexually abused on Rikers and exploited because they're there probably for solicitation of sex. They're probably being trafficked by someone, which we've met a woman who we recorded and told her story, which their stories are not being told because media doesn't care about that. Media doesn't tell our stories at all, actually. They tell their version.
Yeah.
And it's never the truth.
We have
you hear, so we have the Women of Rikers Project, but we need members to commit to certain committee projects. Those are just two, Humans of Rikers and Women of Rikers. But even if it's going out and tabling. That could be making allowing people the chance to be re-educated by talking to them about Rikers. There's plenty of people that stop and talk to us when we're on the streets. We're, we can be out there also doing flyers. So we have different committees that if you guys want to, in the next couple of days, we're gonna have to build this chart where you can then go on the website, dedicate to this time, or even sign up on paper, and then we'll move forward. Say, if you wanna do, sending flyers out in the train stations, in the parks, in the streets as you're going to work, even at your job. Wouldn't hurt, people see it, and it's done. Literally off some of our flyers, people just call or write our email, and I have to like respond back. Answering emails is another thing. Or when the people sign up, we have a part on there that says, do you want to volunteer? And they say yes, a lot of them. So why aren't we utilizing that and growing ourselves so that we become a huge collective?
School to prison pipeline.
Exactly.
And we really don't have any services in the community to help families. If a wife is having problems with her husband, she might need her husband to get help. There's no services to help people. The only setup that they really have is to convict people. That's the only setup. Whether you're having problems at home, having problems with your son, your husband, your uncle, there's no kind of therapy or an environment where people have a safe space. It's like the only solution is to lock people up.